So, Colin, what we saw here was your wife and your daughter in your new TV series. And I wonder, when I watch it, how often are you on the receiving end of that mood?
This is my life story.
But not you ever?
We're a little bit like that at home.
True?
Yes.
So how do you respond to it?
I go upstairs, switch on the television, and watch football.
How? I mean, you do big productions. You've made so many films, and it's big budgets, and it's a lot of people, and it's a lot of stress. How stressed are you?
I don't stress.
How can you
it's
say that?
It's that simple.
Well, everyone's stressed.
Well, maybe I stress without knowing it. But I mean,
but you really feel you don't stress?
No, I don't stress. I think if you talk to anyone who worked with me, they would say I'm the least stressed on the crew. I mean, it's like this. If you stress at all, it's in getting the money to make the film, a beggar, knocking on doors, asking, you know, I want to make a film, can I have the money? Once you've got the money, if you have your actors and you have your crew, I feel you've done the worst part of the job. Making films is a wonderful way to live. And the money is not mine. I think the people stressing are the people around. So
no, people but I mean, owns the money.
That's exactly.
They're the ones stressing.
But in a way, I'm serious, because if you think about that when you film, you'd never make a good film. You have to get that out of your head. To me, it's like Monopoly. I mean, I grew up, I was born in 1944. I mean, the war was on the edge of ending.
Now we're in the south of England, right?
Now we're living in the south of England. When we used to go to my grand's shop, we would go on a bus that would go past, you know, like Satsuset, bombed to the ground, streets bombed to the ground. But, of course, as a kid, I think about this now when you see war zones that to us look like, how can you live there? Well, if you're a kid, of course you can. That's all you've ever known. Roof, you know, houses with no roofs and, you know, cinemas that are not there anymore. So you couldn't avoid the war. And Portsmouth was the biggest dockyard in the world at the time. And, of course, it was bombed to hell.
But since you started working in the business, in the entertainment business, and your first years, was it? They were in Britain, of course.
Yeah.
You got to work with a lot of big stars. I mean, who was the most difficult, do you think, looking back?
Well, I worked with a lot of difficult people, but the one who takes the biscuit was Orson Welles, I guess.
Orson Welles, the actor.
Yeah.
And director.
And director, and
the man
genius,
who gave us Citizen Kane.
Yes, yeah. You know, 23 years old and still voted the best film ever, I think.
What was your job? What did...
I was the assistant director. So, I mean, I was the one that stood in between the director, who Orson Welles hated, and took, you know, the problems both ways.
But what made him difficult?
Well, he wasn't difficult to me. He was wonderful to me. But he was difficult to the photographer, who he couldn't stand, taking photographs. The director, who he had no respect for. Actually, the makeup girl, who did it too hard on his face. He had a wild temper. And he wasn't very well. And he was drinking every day, all day. And I said to him at one point, why are you doing this? He said, I need the money. Like everybody else, he has to live. He had an old lady, and she looked after him and did everything for him. She came up to me and said, could he take a longer lunch today, Colin? He's going to meet a friend in his favourite restaurant. So I said, all right, off you go, but please don't be too long, because it's me that gets my head kicked in. 3 o'clock, 4 o'clock, 5 o'clock, he still doesn't come back. The director now is going berserk. And I think it was 6:45. In walks Orson. you know, and he was huge. This, you know, just like you think of him, with the big hat and the long scarf. Very kind of happy guy, walked in with this little old lady by his side. I said, Orson's here. Okay, fine. I went into the back room that was his little room and said, where the hell have you been? You know, I'm lucky to still be alive. He'd been to Paris. His parents. That's...
How could he?
Private plane. Of course he did this job. He needed money. I mean, if you were going to live like that, to take a private plane from Heathrow to Paris and back...
But his favourite restaurant, was that in Paris?
It was in Paris. So, you know...
You ended up in Sweden almost by accident.
Totally by accident.
But what was your first impression of Sweden?
Nightmare.
Why was that?
It was a nightmare. I came to Sweden again as an assistant director to work with Swedish television on a children's drama. And...
So you came to Stockholm?
I came to Stockholm. And I actually went by taxi to Heathrow. The taxi driver, I've got to say one thing. He said, I tell you about Sweden, the sun never shines. It's got the highest suicide rate in the world. The women are beautiful. It's the centre of pornography. And I looked out of the... No, and it's, yeah, it's full of pine trees. And as we came into Arlanda then, in the 70s, number one, that's all I could see, pine trees. Nothing else but pine trees. By the time we got into the taxi, it was black. The sun had gone, you know, it was sort of mid-afternoon. So we drive across Stockholm and we eventually stop at the door of what to me looked like a kind of bar or a club. And when we actually walked in, we were kind of on the stage. There were two people who looked as though they were having sex. They probably weren't, but we felt they probably are. And it was a club that used to be here called Chat Noir. I think very famous at the time. So, you know, three Englishmen in the mid-70s.
This sounds more like Copenhagen, I think.
Wow. Well, I tell you what, it's not Oslo, that's for sure.
Not Oslo.
Not Oslo. The Norwegians would not say...
Chat Noir in Oslo is a very decent theatre, actually.
It is. Well, it was a very decent theatre in Stockholm on that night because we were like, what in hell's name? So we were sort of... And pine trees, dark. Every woman that we looked at coming out of England looked stunningly beautiful. And we were now in the centre of pornography. It was like the taxi driver, you know, got everything right. But we came back in the summer to the most wonderful country that I'd ever been to. The sun never stopped
shining. Oh, it's a very different thing, isn't it?
Oh, so different. And, I mean, I fell in love.
Before we move on, yeah. I mean, I could speak Swedish with you, or I can't speak Swedish, but
I knew you were gonna
say that. But... What's your thing with the Swedish language? Because you understand it,
yes.
But you never speak it.
No.
How bad is it?
My Swedish
is it?
Appalling. I mean, you can't live in a home like mine where you've only got to say one Swedish word and everyone bursts out laughing to sort of feel confident. But also, there is another thing. I know when Helena is really angry... as something that I do, she switches immediately to Swedish. So when Helena's talking Swedish to me, you know, I'm in trouble.
Bröllop, begravning och dop är att se på Simor nu och strax oss på TV4. Thank you, Colin Nutley.
My pleasure.
Hope you enjoyed the clip. For more interesting conversations, please hit subscribe.